The Mahabharata by Dr. N. V. R. Krishnamacharya, Adiparva, Chapter 4, Shakuntala, the Baby of the Birds. Dushyanta, a descendant of Puru, extended the boundaries of the kingdom and ruled over a vast empire, One day, he went on a hunting expedition into the deep woods. Eventually, the hunting party encamped near the hermitage of the reputed sage Kanva. The hermitages in ancient India, called ashramas in Sanskrit, were the colonies founded by, apart from the royal capital cities of kings and the villages of the rustics, the ashramas were centers of learning, and ascetics who preferred to live in far-off forest colonies, far from the madding crowds, ignoble strife, were held in great esteem by the kings and the commoners. The ashramas were secluded forest universities of ancient India, where the Vedas, Upanishads, and other sacred literature were taught and produced. Even secular wisdom like polity and economics were taught there. Besides the urban and rural life, there was a highly cultured life in the seclusion of forest recesses centered around ascetic teachers. These ashramas kept alive the bright fires of learning and spiritual thought. Young men of noble birth eagerly sought education at these ashramas. World-weary age went there for peace. These centers of culture were cherished by the rulers of the land, and not the proudest of them dared to treat the members of their hermitages otherwise than with respect and consideration. The chief of the ashram was called the Kulapati, meaning head of the colony. An ideal Kulapati was expected to provide education to 6,000 students with free boarding and lodging facilities. The ashram symbolized simple living and high thinking. Poets grew into ecstasy while describing the deer and the lion lived in the ancient Indian ashram in perfect harmony. In spite of the obvious exaggeration, the ashram was a center of peace and harmony, learning and light. The ashram was a cultural lighthouse, and it had a spiritual halo around it. Emperor Dushyanta, having learnt that the ashrama of the reputed sage Kanva was situated in the vicinity of his encampment, decided to go and pay his homage of reverence to the saint. He entered the ashram with all humility, taking off all the insignia of regal splendor. At that time, the sage Kanva was away on a private mission, but Dushyanta was received as an honored guest. The ashram etiquette ordains that any guest, even a perfect stranger, should be treated with due respect. The uninvited guest to enjoy the status of God himself. Emperor Dushyanta was received by a maiden named Shakuntala with all the ashram hospitalities, and the charming host was introduced to the emperor as the dear daughter of Kanva. It was an enigmatic proposition to the emperor, as the Kulapati was known to be a lifelong celibate. So he asked for clarification. Shakuntala herself narrated the story of her birth to the emperor. Dushyanta listened, bestowing his rapt attention and flattering concern to every syllable spoken by Shakuntala. The celebrated sage Vishwamitra undertook the performance of penance with deep dedication, causing great concern to the Lord of Heaven in the glamour girls of his court, famous for their artful and seductive blandishments. Vishwamitra's reputation for easy irritation and fiery haughtiness struck terror into the hearts of the divine damsels, and nobody came forward to undertake, fraught with the danger of a devastating curse. However, Menaka, known for her outstanding beauty and dynamism, was entrusted with the delicate duty. When Menaka descended to the spot where Vishwamitra was engrossed in deep meditation, The whole for meditation, the whole forest was in a vernal bloom. Nature seemed to offer the fullest collaboration to the divine damsel. The cuckoo's voice was reverberating across the hills and dales. The placid waves of the river Malini were dancing to the tunes of the southern wind. Spring creepers showered their fragrant blossoms on the sage. He opened his eyes and perceived the heavenly maiden. Just at that moment, gentle breeze blew, disturbing her upper garment, unveiling her robust breast lines and the slender waist together with its three folds. In no time, the penance of the sage gave way to passion. However, he was overwhelmed with repentance as soon as Menaka gave birth to a baby, and he retreated to resume his penance. Menaka returned to the kingdom of Indra, leaving the child on the sands of Malini to the protecting care of the birds of the forest. Fortunately, the baby was seen by the Kulapati Kanva when he went to the Malini to offer his morning oblations. He immediately picked up the tender baby in true. Ancient sages in India conquered sensuality, but they never slaughtered their sensitivity. The child acquired the name of Shakuntala, the baby of the birds. Dushyanta was very happy to learn that Shakuntala was in fact the daughter of the Kshatriya sage Vishwamitra by the celestial nymph Menaka. The emperor proposed to marry her and occupy the queen's palace, which is worthy of her beauty. He added that the hermitage with its rustic surroundings was not at all a congenial place for her to live. Shakuntala inherited the bewitching beauty of her mother and the brilliant brains of her father. She replied that she was a virgin under the protective care of her foster father, who should be approached by the emperor. Dushyanta as semi-consent and proposed the Gandharva marriage then and there, and said that the scriptures enjoined it as an acceptable form of marriage for the Kshatriyas. She stipulated a condition that the child born out of their union should succeed him to the throne. He gladly accepted a proposition, as he fervently longed for the birth of the heir to his throne. Dushyanta stayed in the ashram for some days and returned to his capital, promising Shakuntala to send his ministerial retinue to escort the capital. But all the while he was feeling guilty of the passionate indiscretion he committed in the privacy of the ashram presence without the knowledge of the great sage Kanva. So no royal retinue was dispatched to fetch the queen as promised. Meanwhile, Shakuntala gave birth to a son. Kanva patiently awaited the arrival of the royal messengers to send Shakuntala and the child to Dushyanta. The boy gradually grew into a daring child and acquired the name of Simhadamana, as he fearlessly dragged the lion cubs from their mothers and played with them. Kanva took care to bring him up in the regal tradition, and Simhadamana soon acquired princely aptitudes with instinctive precocity. The boy was the grandson of the ever dynamic royal sage Vishwamitra, who was the architect of a parallel universe on the mother's side, and the son of the renowned warrior Dushyanta, respected as a companion and colleague of Indra, the ruler of heaven. Kanva, having waited too long, decided to send the gallant prince to his father, together with the mother Shakuntala, who was obliged to lead a solitary life of shattered dreams in the ashram silently. Appropriate escort was provided, and Shakuntala, the royal city, together with the child. Dushyanta disclaimed her in the open court, lest after the interval the whole episode would be considered a promiscuous misadventure on part of the emperor following a hunting excursion. It was an intriguing situation. It was an intriguing situation for Shakuntala, too deep for tears. She was reduced to utter helplessness, but she knew that truth was on her side. She appealed to the emperor, giving a lengthy discourse on truth. Truth, she said, would outweigh the four Vedas. Truth was greater than 100 Ashwamedha Yagas. Every syllable uttered by Shakuntala was replete with innocence associated with the ashramite veracity. But what was the use of the holy harangue of Shakuntala at this juncture? Dushya also knew the truth, which he feared to acknowledge publicly. At last, Shakuntala suggested a test. She wanted Dushyanta to embrace the boy. She said, "O king, the cool radiance of crystal pearls, mellifluous moonlight, the floral fruits, cool sandal paste or camphor are by no means equal to the exclusive exhilaration derived from the embrace of a son. Here is your son. Experience it and you shall know the truth," and exhorted the boy to go to his father. As the boy, looking every inch a prince and a chip of the chivalrous block, jumped to his feet, Akashvani, the heavenly voice, pronounced to the delight of one and all, "Shakuntala has spoken the truth. Simhadamana is your son." Simhadamana found himself in the filial embrace. The courtiers, who were already convinced, extended their hearty congratulations to the king and warm welcome to the heir apparent. Shakuntala and Dushyant lived a happy life after their dramatic reunion. It is one of the most remarkable features of ancient Indian culture that great emperors, in the height of their glory and achievement, renounced their crowns to live as recluses in the forest in the evenings of their lives for the sake of spiritual self-realization. Eventually, Dushyanta crowned the heir apparent as the emperor and departed to the deep woods, followed by Shakuntala. Simhadamana, renamed Bharata, performed the Ashwamedha Yaga and brought the whole under a single umbrella, the insignia of unrivaled royalty in those days. Ever since, India, the country over which he ruled, came to be known as Bharata after his name.